have a great show today. It's a tribute to Elvis. I really know you're going to like this one. We got Elvis's private nurse, Miss Marion Cox, Larry Moss, one of the great all-time collectors of memorabilia in the Memphis area, and a tribute to the late Scotty Moore, who passed away recently. I think you're going to like what you see. And also, we have a clip about Muhammad Ali. He came one year to the Elvis Memorial Service. You'll have to bear with us now. History sometimes is a little fuzzy, but I think we'll get through that one. So hang with us on the show today. Marion Cox, how you doing?
I'm good, George. How are you?
Miss Nurse, huh?
That's right.
Well, first time I met this lady, she had a little pill box on her head, white pill box. Her outfit was perfect. It was pleats. I mean, when he pleats, it was all pressed or something.
Mm-hmm.
What floor were you on, Miss Cox?
I had 17 Madison East, I think it was, when I met Elvis.
Is that what it was?
Mm-hmm. It was either 17 or 18 Madison
East. That's the old Baptist Hospital.
That's right.
Now, how did you get assigned to Elvis? Well,
Dr. Nick came up on the floor one day and took me aside and said that Elvis was sick and he needed to bring him to the hospital, and he wanted him on my floor. And I said, oh, okay. And he said, do you have a suite available? And I said, well, I do have, and I can lock it till he gets here. So just let me know. And he said, well, now I want you to take care of him. And he said, he's going to come in the morning. Well, it was on a Friday. And I said, Dr. Nick, I won't be here tomorrow, but whoever's in charge, I'll have them take care of me. He said, oh, no, you got to be here. You got to be here. And I said, I don't give it 2 days off a week. And he said, please, if you won't do it for Elvis, do it for me. And I said, well, I'll do it. You know, I'll do it. I'll come in on my day off.
So what happened?
Which I did. And I came in on my day off. And you know, George, it's real funny. They called me about 5:30 and said that he was ready to go to the hospital. I got ready, got in there. And when I walked in that outside door at Baptist, I knew he was already there. I mean, you can believe it or not, there was nothing but pure static electricity in that building.
Wow.
And I got on the elevator and went straight up to my floor, and my night nurse was at the desk, and she said, Miss Cox, he's already here. And I said, I know it. And I went in my office and took off my coat and hat. And you know, I'd never been an Elvis fan. I later told him that. It's a funny story in itself. But anyway, as I walked down that hall, the closer I got to that room, the more excited I got. And I walked in that room, and Linda was shaving him, and Vernon, and Joe, and maybe Dick. I'm not sure who the third one was, but there were
maybe people. Jerry Schilling.
No, it wasn't Jerry Schilling. But anyway, I walked in and looked at him, and he looked at me, and Dr. Nick immediately said, "This is Joe, and this is so and so, and this is Vernon, and whatever." And he said, and you know who this is? I said, yeah, I think I know who that is. So when they left within 5 minutes, and as they went out the door, Joe said, boss.
Joe Esposito.
Joe Esposito said, boss, we have to talk about private duty nurses for you. And Elvis said, well, I'm going to talk to Ms. Cox first. And so they left, and we sat there and visited. He got to know me. I got to know him. And a movie came on, Brian's Song.
Oh, yeah.
And we both cried all through that movie.
Yeah, great.
And all he wanted was, of course, I gave him his medications and checked his blood pressure and all this, that, and the other. I wore my uniform. And he, so finally about 1:30, he said, what do you want me to do about private duty nurses? And I said, honey, that's entirely up to you. What do you want to do about private duty nurses? He said, well, I'll have them if you want me to, but I want you to take care of me. Mm-hmm. And that was, you know, I took a Hippocratic oath a long time before the government ever thought about it. And I've never broken it. And so the things that he told me then are still confidential. I've never discussed
it. You hold on to those. Some days we'll get you off to the side. Me and you and Jerry Schilling will share
some
stories. Ms. Cox, we got a few minutes here, but talk about your CD. I see a CD there and a book.
Well, let me tell you about this book. It never would have come to be had it not been for Vernon Presley.
Okay.
And the reason it came to be was...
Show it so the camera can get a shot of it.
He was... Vernon was in the hospital for some test, and I had gone up to see him, and he was very, very distraught about the bad books coming out about Elvis. And so I told him, I said, Vernon, I've written my memories of your son And actually, Bob was the one I suggested that I do that so that when I got too old to remember, I could go back and read my book, read my notes. And I had two of those secretarial-type notebooks that I had written all this in, and I had them in my camphor chest at home. And so I told Vernon what I had done. I said, I've written down my memories of your boy, but I said, there's nothing bad in them, because I knew nothing bad about him. Yeah. And he said, can I read them? And when I took them to him, he went home the next day and called me 2 days later at the hospital and said, would you come out and have a cup of coffee with me? I said, I will. So I went out to Graceland. He lived at Dolan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And went out there and had coffee, and Sandy was there, of course.
That was the young lady that Mr. Presley was dating at that time, so to speak.
Sandy Miller. And so we had coffee, and then he picked up my two notebooks, and he said, I want you to do something for me. And I said, I'll do anything I can for you, Vernon. He said, I want this published. I said, I can't do that. He said, why? And I said, Vernon, I never took a salary from Elvis the whole time I was with him. I'm not going to make money off of him now.
Oh, you got a tribute to Elvis coming up.
I do. The Elvis Presley Memorial Dinner Charity Event, the 12th of August at the Lindenwood Christian Church.
Are tickets still available?
Yes, they are. And they can write to me or call me. And they don't know my number, but they can find it on Facebook. They can go Google me.
Okay. Ms. Cox, thank you for coming down. We do it like that. You got it down pat. Marion Cox, Elvis's private nurse, Memphis Sounds with GK. George Klein and Memphis Sounds helping to promote our music heritage here at the library, but we need your help. We need your support. The number to call is 901-415-2833. Larry Moss, my man. How you doing, Larry?
Great, George.
Ladies and gentlemen, this guy right here, Larry Moss, I've known for many, many years, is probably one of the top collectors of very valuable, what would you call it, Larry?
Elvis memorabilia.
Yeah. Elvis, and you've got so many wonderful things today. He has got, ladies and gentlemen, a couple of very historic guitars and a very historic robe. We'll talk about the guitars in just a moment, but Larry Moss from Memphis, Tennessee, has Elvis Presley's very first guitar, a K guitar, the guitar that Elvis's mom, Gladys, bought him at a hardware store in Tupelo, Mississippi. And then he gave that guitar to Red West, and we'll get into that in just a few minutes. Then you got Scotty Moore's guitar. Bless his heart, Scotty Moore passed away just recently. What a great guy, what a great musician, and very loyal to Elvis. That's why we're bringing Scotty's guitar out today. Larry Moss, tell us a story about Elvis's first guitar.
Well, the guitar, like you said, was bought at Tupelo Hardware Store for Elvis's 11th birthday.
Can you hold it so the camera can get a shot of it?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, there it is right there. Be careful now.
Yeah, it's pretty fragile and in pretty rough shape, but like I said, Elvis had gone with his mother to Tupelo Hardware Store to get a birthday present for his 11th birthday. When they went into the store, they saw a .22 rifle up on the wall, and Elvis wanted the rifle. His mother didn't want him to have the rifle. He kind of, again, he's 11 years old. He kind of whined and threw a little bit of a fit. And the store clerk, a man named Forrest Bobo, pulled the guitar out from under the counter and convinced Elvis to sit down and start playing with it a little bit. And eventually Gladys convinced him that if he would take the guitar and forget about the rifle, that his mother would pay the difference. They paid a whopping $7.75 plus 2% sales tax for the guitar.
And then, so as I recall, Red was doing some bodyguard type work for Elvis on the road, but he was going back to college to play football down in Mississippi at Jones County Junior College. And so he had given Elvis had given Red that, tell Red that story.
Well, they were working together a little bit, had been traveling around. Elvis was doing the local performances and things like that. And they'd gone to Florida and came back. And on the way back, Elvis bought Red a car. Walked off and left him in the lot. He didn't know how to drive the car. He eventually gets back to Memphis and realizes he'd never gotten a chance to even say thank you. So from there, he goes straight over to Elvis's house. They lived on Getwell.
Yeah, in East Memphis.
That's right, at the time, to say thank you. And because he was leaving the next morning, like you said, to go down to Jones Junior College and play football on a scholarship. And he was there and getting ready to leave. And Elvis had been traveling, working with Red. And Scotty had been teaching.
That's right.
Scotty had been teaching Red how to play the guitar. And so Elvis went in the back and came back out with this guitar and handed it to him and said, here, I want you to take this to college with you because I want you to keep practicing practicing and keep learning because you're doing pretty good, and I've been watching what Scotty's been teaching you. And that's how he got the guitar.
Well, that was Elvis's guitar.
That is.
That is a very historic. That's the guitar that Elvis played on all those early Sun records.
In the very beginning, the very first Sun record, all through high school, the stories of him bringing his guitar to school.
That's right.
And the talent show at Humes High School and things like that.
I was there.
And
yeah.
Old Shep, and that first, certainly that first recording that he supposedly made for his mother, but we know that was more of an audition or whatever that he was trying to get Sam to look at. And whether or not he played it on That's All Right Mama or not, we don't know. We just know that he didn't buy his first guitar at OK Halk until August of 1954, and That's All Right Mama was recorded in July of 54, so can't prove that it was, but certainly is no proof that it wasn't actually played on That's All Right Mama.
Well, I'll tell you, I bet a bottom dollar that it was Elvis's first guitar, because when he went over to Sun Records with Scotty Moore that night to audition to try to sing that song that Sam Phillips had for him, that's the only guitar Elvis had.
And Scotty told the story for years, forever, that there was not a recording session when it started. It was just an audition.
Right.
And that the recording was a mistake as much as anything else.
Yeah. That's right. And he took the cut a demo real quick, took it up to Dewey Phillips, and Dewey played it seven times that night on local WHBQ radio, and it took off like a jet, and Elvis was on his way. I noticed today that you brought this robe in. Tell us the story of the Muhammad Ali robe that Elvis had made.
Bill Ballou was the designer and the maker of pretty much all of the jumpsuits that Elvis ever wore.
Right.
And the company was IC Costumes. And Elvis got Bill Ballou to make a robe for Muhammad Ali that he wanted to give Ali as a gift. And that right there is an exact reproduction from Bill Ballou's patterns and photographs and sketches or whatever of the actual robe that was first made.
So, and Ali wore that robe to the Kenny Norton fight, as I recall, which he lost, and never wore it again. I think he donated it to his museum in Louisville, Kentucky,
or something
to that effect. So that is an exact replica, isn't it?
It was made from the actual patterns that were used to make the robe that was given to Ali, and it was made a number of years later by basically the same company, BK Enterprises, which took over, if you will, all of the IC costume patterns and things that originally came from Bill Ballou.
Well, Scotty Moore's guitar, we're going to get to Scotty later on today, but Scotty's always played a Gibson, hadn't he?
That's correct.
He never played a Martin or one of the other fancy guitars. It was always the Gibson.
He liked the Gibson because it had a big full body. Apparently, maybe when he was in the service, he'd gotten one of these Japanese guitars when he was overseas or whatever, but as soon as he got back to the States and saw the Gibson and the full body, that it has the thickness and the depth of it, then that's what he played, and he's played.
We're going to get to that in just a few minutes on the show today. But Scotty Moore, how many Gibsons did he have, Larry?
I know that he had this one for the first all of the Sun records. But right after that, Gibson came out with, this is an ES-295. Gibson then came out with what they called an L-5, which was really the same guitar, but just with a little bit bigger body. The body was even bigger and a little thicker. And again, the bigger the body, the more Scotty liked it. And that's when he got that, and that's what he played through the later years. There have been maybe three or four other guitars later in the late years, but for the purposes of the Elvis recordings and playings and stuff like that, it was either this, the ES-295 on the Sun records, or the Gibson L5 after that.
That is actually how people ask me, why did Elvis play a Gibson? Well, because Scotty was playing a Gibson, and he told me, and this Gibson people sent him, so well, look, here's one for Presley, see if he likes it. And Elvis liked the Gibson and used it all the time.
Yeah.
Well, Larry, thanks for coming down, my man. What a great interview with you, man. I hope I could go on and on with this guy, you know, man, because he comes from our family, so to speak, in North Memphis, and we knew his brother and his daddy and everybody, and your sister and all that stuff. Larry, thanks for coming down. And you're a jewel itself from Memphis, Tennessee, because I don't know anybody in another part of the country that's got what you got, especially on Elvis Presley.
Thank you.
Other than Graceland, you know.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thanks for coming down. Larry Moss, GK, Memphis Sounds. George Clyde in Memphis Sounds, and we're saluting, well, I say, yes, that would be the right word. Muhammad Ali passed away recently, and Elvis Presley, of course, is passing away. It's coming up the August 16th. We want to salute Elvis also, always. But we got in touch with Muhammad Ali once. We have a memorial service for Elvis at the University of Memphis every year. And I got in touch with Muhammad Ali. We had a mutual friend, and asked him if he'd come in and speak at Elvis's memorial service. And he said he sure would, because Ali really liked Elvis. Muhammad Ali, there was only one.
Elvis Presley. I first heard back in 19, you fans liked them when the song came out, Don't Be Cruel. I love that song. What year was it? Some of you all. They really wanted me. I never heard a song so beautiful. I can't sing. Even though I keep going. I love that song. That song converted me. We black people are kind of funny by music. And we don't follow nothing but what we call soul. Little Richard. Chuck Berry. Michael Jackson. But the only white boy I saw who could sing as good as any of them was Elvis. Elvis was a great singer, so black. And I'm one who believes in black pride, and blacks have a chance as good as anybody. But there's one man as good as anybody. I mean, all the brothers together, I heard none no better than Elvis Presley. Not just the singing ability, he had everything. He was pretty. When it comes to boxing, nobody has the class, the style, the wit, the speed, the beauty. When it comes to singing, nobody had anything like Elvis. I understand he did not for poor people. He had a good heart, he helped me. He just wasn't a person who was great with talent, but great in spirit, but had God in his heart. And this is great too. I realize how good I am in my profession. I wouldn't praise nobody. If he didn't deserve it. Because I am the greatest of all time. That's in boxing. And I'm telling you, not just you, you all are Elvis fans, so naturally, you praise Elvis. He's of European race, you are. But I'm black, I'm Islamic, I'm 100% different from you, and I tell the world, Elvis is the greatest of all time. And I Muslim who's black, who stands up for what he believes, who don't have to say what I don't feel, and don't have what I'm not forced, I don't have to say this, I have no bosses, I'm free. He's, to me, one of the greatest singers, actors, all around, man of all time.
Ladies and gentlemen, Scotty Moore, who was Elvis's first guitar player and played on a lot of Elvis's big million sellers, passed away recently. And we had Scotty Moore in our studios not too very long ago, and Scotty brought down some of his instruments. He had like his first Gibson guitar, and he had this, and he had that. And we got him to open up on a lot of stories about playing guitar for Elvis and on the road and things that went down and what happened, so forth and so on. So we're going to show you a little excerpts from this video that we did with Scotty Moore many moons ago. Scotty Moore, my man. Boy, we've been making this for a long time. Miss Gail, I can't reach that far. Miss Gail Pollock, anyway,
that's
Scotty, hit her on the hand or something.
That's
over here.
Close enough. Yeah.
But, you know, I didn't know until I read you. By the way, Scotty has out a new book. That's why he's on tour promoting the book. And also that guitar, we'll talk about that later today. But Scotty has a new book called Scotty and Elvis Aboard the Mystery Train. And I'm lucky enough to be on the back of the book, because I'm going to read you what it says. This Keith Richards of the Rolling Stones, quote unquote, "Everyone else wanted to be Elvis. I wanted to be Scotty." Keith Richards. "Scotty was the rock, sort of like the Pope is the rock of the church. Knowing Elvis and Scotty the way I do, I can see why Elvis depended on Scotty Moore." Jerry Schilling. "And Scotty was there from the very beginning. I learned so much I never knew. Great insight to the early years. One of the best books on Elvis I ever read." A guy named George Klein wrote that blurb, that quote in the back of the book. But Scotty, this is a good book, man.
Thank you.
And you divulged some stuff in there I thought you'd never talk about, son.
I was broke.
Scotty Moore, my man, Mr. Guitar. I've read your book twice, and I noticed that when you started playing those licks, though, you were as much as inventing rock and roll as Elvis was, because you were combining country music with blues, and nobody ever heard that. And Elvis, he knew the song, and then Bill started slapping that bass, and that really was the birth of rock and roll.
Well, I guess that's what everybody says.
Yeah.
We were just playing, you know. And
did you guys know that Sam was going to take it up to Dewey Phillips a couple of nights later?
No. No. We just, he said, he said, "I kind of like that," and said, "We'll..." He went up there and put it on tape, listened to it and everything, and said, "We might, I don't remember his exact words, but it was..."
He said, "We may have to think about a B-side for this."
A B-side, yeah.
Yeah, and, which we didn't do that night. And he said, I'm sure he said something like, "Well, if y'all come up with something else, we'll try it again next day or two, whatever." But in the meantime, he did take it down to do a Phillips at the radio station.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've known this guy from day one. I mean, you know, I was a fledgling disc jockey and hooked up with Elvis. And gosh, Scotty, we went to Canada, we went to Hawaii, all across America, crisscrossing America. And that Vancouver concert almost killed us all.
I could still remember that, the Canada concert.
Wow.
I can remember you on the back of that car. "Hurry up, let's get out of here." The crowd was coming down out of the bleachers. They wouldn't let the crowd go on the field because they had a game the next day, and they
That's
didn't
right.
want this big, huge crowd to mess up. So they were all in the bleachers. You're talking. You remember it, don't you?
Very well, because you were driving that old limousine, and Gail, we said, everybody, "Jump in the limousine, GK, jump in the limo." Well, Elvis was already gone.
Oh, yes.
He left in a police car. They thought he was in the limo, see? And they started rocking that car, and Scotty's behind the wheel. Me and DJ and Bill was in the back. And they start, this is a true story. They broke the aerial off the car.
Right.
They pulled the license plate off the car.
Right.
And then, to top it all off, one guy took a knife and went down the side of the car to get some paint for a souvenir. And I rolled the window down, and I said, and there's a Royal Canadian Mounted Police, great big old guy, and I said, "Man, can't you stop me tearing up Elvis's car?" He said, "Oh, Presley's got a lot of money. He can buy another one."
Yep.
But at that time, I said, "Scotty, hit that horn and hit that gas pedal. It's either them or us." And man, we barely got out of there, didn't we, Scotty?
They wouldn't have hurt anybody, but just the mob would have just
crushed
us. But,
when I look back out of the rear window, the stage was just modeled. It looked like a bomb hit the stage. Sheet music was flying up in the air. Yeah. Music stands was flying up. Sound equipment they were grabbing it as souvenirs. Yeah. It was really crazy in Vancouver, Canada.
You said that you had learned a great deal from Scotty's book. there's a story that I want you to tell, that Scotty was very surprised when we got your book about the fact that you were in the radio room the very first time that Elvis, Scotty, and Bill played in public at the opening of the Katz Drug Store.
That's right. I was the MC. It was a flatbed truck. You're right, Gail. Because I'm not bragging, but stating fact, I'm probably the only disc jockey in the world that introduced Elvis and the Beatles. I did the Beatles later years. But I was working freelancing for some advertising agency at WHBQ or somewhere. And I was out there all day long playing records. And then it had this flatbed truck. And Elvis is going to be there with Scotty and Bill that night. I don't think DJ was with us at that time. And so I got to introduce, and Elvis saw me, his eyes got big. Oh, GK, how you doing? He was happy because that was one of his first gigs. And on a flatbed truck, and I was excited. And I didn't think anything about it then, you know. And as years went by, I said, "Wow!" I introduced Elvis on the back of a flatbed truck.
That was Scotty and Bill and Elvis's very first public appearance, and it was the opening of a Katz Drug Store.
That's right.
And on a truck.
The Meyer Way Shopping Center.
People who know the Elvis myth don't have any idea how he really started.
That's right.
And to give. Give Bill credit. If it hadn't been for Bill in those very early days, I don't think it would have ever happened.
Why is that, Scotty?
Because he would ride the bass and holler and carry on all of the antics, just and get Elvis would get him going.
Yeah,
and it just all kind of started working together.
But Scotty, you guys created a new sound, and Rolling Stone and all those magazines have said and given you credit for it that you and Elvis actually. The reason that rock and roll was born in that little studio at 706 Union.
Well, that may be true, but it wasn't. We didn't know we was creating something new. It was just a matter of the two of us doing what we liked.
Right.
It was a little different, but we didn't know it at that point that it was different, really.
But Scotty, you played that lick, that blues country lick, and nobody ever done that before. You know,
he has said in the past that what he was doing was filling up space because Sam had said, "Don't bring the whole band, just you and Bill come in and lay down a little rhythm. I want to hear what he sounds like on tape."
That's true.
And so there were only the three of them. And if you listen to the music, if you take out the if you take out the voice, it's the guitar that fills in all the dead space.
Yeah, yeah.
And so Scotty said that a whole lot of the time he wasn't trying to create something new, he was just trying to fill up the empty spots.
Boy, did you ever create something new. And the one and only Elvis Erwin Presley takes us to the house.
Memories press between the pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Quiet thoughts come floating down and settle softly through the ground like gold of autumn leaves around my feet. I touch them and they burst apart with sweet memories.